Hello all. Once again, welcome back to our class. Welcome back to our lecture series. I'm excited. This will be the last lecture of this class. It's been a long ride. It's been a nice one with you guys too. I'll see you guys next time. Okay, let's take it off from there immediately. We'll be talking about the last part of module 24, which is cellular signaling. All right, let's take it off immediately. Hormones in carbohydrate metabolism, that's basically what we're talking about. We're talking about these three hormones in fuel metabolism, the epinephrine or the adrenaline, the glucagon, and the insulin. We've talked about them a little bit when we looked at the carbohydrate metabolism, but now we're going to be taking more time to look at their mechanism of action via the second messengers that we talked about in the previous lecture. So epinephrine or adrenaline, it's an amino acid hormone. It is derived from the amino acid tyrosine. It acts on the muscle tissues to raise blood glucose. The action of glucagon and adrenaline are very close because both of them act to increase the level of blood glucose in the body. That's exactly what both glucagon and epinephrine does. However, the epinephrine is also called the flight and flight hormone because it is a quick switch. So it stimulates quickly gluconeogenesis, the synthesis of glucose, which is released in the bloodstream. Glucagon, on the other hand, is a peptide hormone that contains about 29 amino acids. We can see it's a protein hormone. It's released by the alpha cells of the islet of Langerhans in the pancreas, and it acts on the liver to increase the availability of glucose too. So it promotes gluconeogenesis as well, and then it also promotes gluconeogenesis and inhibits glycogenesis, which is the synthesis of glycogen. The synthesis of glycogen will take away glucose from the blood. On the other hand, insulin works in direct opposition to these two. The main function of insulin, of course, is produced by the beta cells of the islet of Langerhans of the pancreas. It triggers a feedback that ensures that blood glucose level is not in excess, it's reduced. And what it does is that it promotes the breakdown of glucose through glycolysis. It promotes the removal of glucose from the blood through glycogenesis as well, so that you can convert the glucose to glycogen and store them under the muscle and in the liver. That's what it, and a host of other things it does to make sure that the blood glucose level does not get excessive. And the last part of this class, we'll be looking at where someone lacks insulin in diabetes, and we'll see what relationship that has to do with the metabolism of carbohydrate. Okay, let's take it off from the epinephrine. Structure related to amino acid tyrosine. I said that earlier, this tyrosine, if you look at this and this, you see there's a very strong structural similarity. The few differences we have is that the amino group is still here, but here there's a methyl group attached. Here it doesn't have the carboxyl group. It has an OH group here and also has another OH group here. So it is an amino acid hormone, amino acid derivative. It is released from the adrenal gland in response to stress, response to any stress, anything that will make you to run away for your life or fight. That is why we call it the flight or fright hormone, the fright hormone. All right. So how does it act? What is the mechanism of action? It acts through a second messenger, adenylate cyclic AMP, cyclic adenosine monophosphate, that we explained earlier. In the previous lecture, we looked at the three second messengers of cyclic AMP. We looked at calcium and P. We looked at calcium and PIP2, and we looked at tyrosine kinase. So this works with the cyclic AMP. So let's see how it acts. Number one, is an amino acid hormone, so it's definitely binding on the cell membrane. The binding of epinephrine, this is epinephrine bound to the receptor on the cell membrane. Of course, the binding of that activates the G protein. Like, we know how the G protein is activated. We did that already. The G protein now will activate adenylate cyclase to synthesize cyclic AMP. Adenylate cyclase will act on ATP, converting it to AMP. Now, AMP is the second messenger that triggers the phosphorylation of a lot of the protein kinases. This type of protein kinases that depends on this, we call them the cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase. So what does it do? It catalyzes the phosphorylation of this inactive. Whenever we see red, it's inactive. The red means inactive. Inactive CMP dependent protein kinase to an active one by phosphorylation. That's what it does. Now, this protein kinase does two things. Because remember, we said the action of epinephrine is to what? Increase blood glucose. That's what they do. They promote gluconeogenesis and stop any other process that will, like glycogenesis, will reduce blood glucose. So it makes sense that that epinephrine is going to inhibit the synthesis of glycogen. And how does it do that? Look at what it does. In one part, the cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase will go and phosphorylate an active glycogen synthesis. Glycogen synthesis is an enzyme that synthesizes glycogen. Without the phosphate group, it is active. But the moment it is phosphorylated, it gets inactive. So it is this cyclic AMP protein kinase that has been activated that goes to phosphorylate an active glycogen kinase into an inactive one. And an inactive one will result what? The reduction in the synthesis of glycogen, and that will increase blood glucose. All right, of course. Now, in another pathway, look at what happens again. Now, this activated cyclic AMP will go and phosphorylate a protein kinase that phosphorylates the glycogen phosphorylase. Glycogen phosphorylase is the enzyme that breaks down glycogen to glucose. So what is happening here? Now, this cyclic AMP-dependent protein kinase will go and phosphorylate an inactive phosphorylase kinase. It was inactive without the phosphate. The moment it was phosphorylated, it becomes active. It is this active phosphorylase kinase that will now phosphorylate a glycogen phosphorylase that is inactive. The phosphorylation of glycogen inactive phosphorylase, the phosphorylation of inactive glycogen phosphorylase converts it to an active glycogen phosphorylase. And the action of glycogen phosphorylase is to break down glycogen and then convert it to glucose, and in that process, the blood glucose will increase. It will increase blood glucose, and that is actually the effect of epinephrine or adrenaline. Remember, we call it epinephrine or adrenaline. It doesn't matter anyone you want to call it. Let's go to the next one. Now, another hormone that just behaves exactly like the glucagon is. Sorry, that behaves like the epinephrine is the glucagon. Remember, the glucagon again promotes glycogen degradation to produce glucose. It also promotes gluconeogenesis. But it does this in a different way. What happens again is a protein hormone definitely is going to bind the receptor on the what? On the cell membrane. Now, the receptor will now what? Do what? Activate G protein. The stimulatory G protein will activate adenylocyclase to synthesize cyclic AMP. The cyclic AMP will now activate an otherwise inactive cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase to an active one. It is this active protein kinase that will do two things. Let me look at the first part it will do. Now, the active cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase will first of all, look at what it's doing here now. This is phosphofructokinase 2. The phosphofructokinase 2 is the enzyme that synthesizes fructose 2,6 bisphosphate. That's exactly what it does. Now, look at what is happening here now. This enzyme was already active. It was already active at this point. Just like we saw with that of glycogen synthesis when epinephrine deactivated, it was already active. So the phosphorylation of this particular enzyme will render it inactive. And the moment it renders it inactive, the inactive phosphofructokinase 2 can no more make fructose 2,6 bisphosphate. And when it cannot make it, what it means is that this is going to be low. The level of this fructose 2,6 bisphosphate, which is a regulatory molecule, will be low. Because this molecule, what does it do? The increase in concentration of fructose 2,6 bisphosphate promotes glycolysis. So what that means, when it is very low, glycolysis will be suppressed or inhibited. So since this is lower, there will be lack of that allosteric activation provided by fructose 2,6 bisphosphate or F2,6-BP, because there isn't that allosteric activation or promotion that it will provide. That will lead to what? A decrease in the activity of phosphofructokinase, because phosphofructokinase is the enzyme that converts fructose 6-phosphate to fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, and it is activated by this fructose 2,6-bisphosphate. But because this is very low, it is not going to be activated. And when it is not activated, what happens? Glycolysis is suppressed. And when glycolysis is suppressed, what does that tell you? Glucose is not being broken down. Blood glucose increases. Increases. That's exactly what happens. Now let's look at the alternative part again. In the alternative part, again, let's see what's happening here. See, now this is that the inactive cyclic AMP that have been activated. It is phosphorylated by cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase to an active one. The active one will now go and do, look at what it's doing here. This is fructose bisphosphate 2. Fructose bisphosphate 2 is the enzyme that breaks down fructose 2,6 bisphosphate. Now, what is it doing? Look at what is happening here now. The moment this is the inactive enzyme, this will not go and activate it. And if it's activated, what does it do? It's not going to act on this guy and break it. It's acting on this guy and is making sure that this guy is not produced enough. Even if it's produced, it's going to break it down and render it back to fructose 3 phosphate. And the moment that is done, the level of this is going to be low. And when the level of this is below, it will not provide allosteric activation that will make phosphofructokinase 6 to be active to promote glycolysis. Therefore, glycolysis will be suppressed. On the other hand, because this is very low, it will not promote, now, because this is very low, when concentration of fructose 2,6 bisphosphate is low, like I said, it will not provide that allosteric activation for fructose, phosphofructokinase 6. But however, the lower concentration will provide an allosteric activation of fructose bisphosphate. And this fructose bisphosphate, of course, remember, this is fructose bisphosphate is the enzyme that converts fructose 1,6 bisphosphate to fructose 6 phosphate, which is an enzyme in gluconeogenesis that is being promoted by glycogen. So the low concentration of fructose 2,6 bisphosphate lowers, does what? Lower, promotes the activation of fructose bisphosphate. The lower concentration of fructose 2,6 bisphosphate does allosterically activate fructose bisphosphate. And fructose bisphosphate is going to act on fructose 1,6 bisphosphate to convert it to fructose 6, which is second to the last enzyme in what? In gluconeogenesis. And what happens next? The moment that happens, it will now promote gluconeogenesis, because this is an enzyme in gluconeogenesis. So the activation of that enzyme will promote gluconeogenesis, which is synthesis of glucose. And the synthesis of glucose will definitely result in an increase in blood glucose. And that is the very action of glucagon, to promote gluconeogenesis, to suppress glycolysis, and ultimately increase the level of blood glucose in the body. All right, so this is how glucagon does its job. Now we now go to insulin. Insulin, like we said, is a peptide hormone. It's also secreted in the pancreas. It has an active form of 51 amino acids, and it contains two chains, the A chain and the B chain, which are held together by various disulfide bonds. The structures are shown here. The yellow bond shows you the disulfide bonds. All right. So it is created as a proinsulin, an inactive 86 residue that is quickly converted to an active one, which is 51 residue. How does it function? Now, insulin receptors are special because they act through what we call, remember again, the tyrosine kinase receptors. That is how they act. So how does it act? When insulin binds the receptor on the site of this, it binds the receptor on the extracellular side. Remember what we talked about, the tyrosine kinase. The tyrosine kinase receptor has long chains of amino acids, both outside the, in the extracellular part and the intracellular part. So insulin will bind the receptor at the extracellular side of the cell membrane. It will trigger an autophosphorylation of the beta subunit that is protruding into the cell. Now, the autophosphorylation of that side will now trigger what? The phosphorylation of tyrosine in its target cells. Of course, those insulin receptors are called insulin receptor substrates. That's what we call them. And the RS will now act at the second messengers to produce a wide variety of effect. All right. So let's look at how this works. Now, insulin has two receptors. Look at what it does. Insulin has two types of receptor subunits. Now, the alpha is at the top, protruding at the top. The beta are the ones protruding inside the cell. Now, insulin is bound on this side of this receptor. The moment insulin binds, what happens? Insulin will trigger the autophosphorylation of the from this the tyrosine part. It will trigger, the moment it binds here, it will trigger the phosphorylation it does it automatically. The autophosphorylation of the tyrosine side of the beta side. Remember, this is the alpha side, outside. The receptor side of the extracellular cell is the alpha side of the chain. The beta side are inside. So the binding to the alpha side autos the autophosphorylation. The binding of insulin to the alpha side triggers the autophosphorylation of the beta side. The autophosphorylated beta side will now do what? Will trigger the phosphorylation of the insulin receptors on the target organs. And the moment, this is like the liver now, the moment it triggers the phosphorylation of the of this, you know, this is the tyrosine part, you now add phosphate to become. So the moment it triggers, it phosphorylates the insulin receptors on the target organs, it will now result to insulin cellular or biological effect. So this is a quick, a more shorter way, not a shorter way rather, but it is a way in which insulin does not act through the second messenger of cyclic AMP or G protein. Rather, it does this through, like we saw in the last video, the tyrosine kinase. The tyrosine kinase second messengers, which, because most, both this one has the tyrosine group. Remember, the tyrosine has, let me just draw a shortcut, has this OH group. This is where the phosphorylation occurs to form the phosphoester bond. So, and the target cells too, which is called insulin, look at what they're called, the insulin receptor substrate. So these insulin receptor substrate are receptors that are on the target cells, which are now phosphorylated. And the phosphorylation of those insulin receptor substrate on the target cells will now trigger this physiological effect. And the physiological effect of insulin is to make sure that the glycolysis is promoted. That's one of the ways of clearing glucose from the bloodstream. And it also promotes glycogenesis in the liver and the muscle. That is one of the ways it will what? Take away glucose from the blood as well. Now, so effect of insulin is a wide spectrum. It doesn't just act only on one thing. And it affects the metabolism of all the fuel molecules, both carbohydrate, proteins, and lipid. Let's see what it's done. This is a summary. Number one, it promotes uptake. In the muscle, it promotes uptake and increases the effect. And the uptake is by the GLUT4 transporter. We talked about this earlier when we talked about carbohydrate metabolism. The GLUT4 transporter are those receptors of insulin that are on the cells. If they are not there, the insulin is not going to recognize the cell because it has to be, glucose has to be transported into the cell before glycolysis will take place. Glucose breakdown, which is through, that is glycolysis. What does it do? It increases the activity of glucokinase. Glucokinase is a specific enzyme that is specific for only, is a type of exokinase that is only specific for glucose. So for glucokinase, it acts on glucose and converts it to glucose 6 phosphate. Then glycolysis. What does it do in glycolysis? In glycolysis, in muscle and liver, it increases the action of phosphofructokinase 1. Phosphofructokinase 1 is the enzyme that converts fructose 6 phosphate to fructose 1,6 bisphosphate. So it increases the activity. And since that enzyme is a glycolytic enzyme, it does what? Reduces the level of blood glucose by breaking glucose down. All right. In acetyl CoA production in the muscle and the liver, it increases. What does it do? It promotes pyruvate dehydrogen. What does pyruvate dehydrogenase do? After glycolysis, the end product of glycolysis is pyruvate. In aerobic respiration, pyruvate itself is converted to acetyl CoA by the enzyme pyruvate dehydrogenase. So what does it do? Insulin promotes or increases the activity of pyruvate dehydrogenase. In glycogen synthesis, in muscle and the liver, what does it do? It increases the activity of glycogen synthesis. Glycogen synthesis is the enzyme that synthesizes glycogen from glucose. And if you can synthesize glycogen from glucose, you're clearing from the blood, that is going to drop the level of blood glucose. Glycogen breakdown, what does it do? In the muscle and the liver, it inhibits the activity or decreases the activity of glycogen phosphorylase. Glycogen phosphorylase is the enzyme that breaks down glycogen into glucose molecules. But you know, insulin doesn't want that. It wants to remove glucose. So what does it do? It's going to inhibit glycogen phosphorylase or decrease its activity so that it cannot break down glycogen to release glucose. Fatty acid synthesis. In fatty acid synthesis in the liver and the muscle, what does it do? Acetyl-CoA carboxylase is the first enzyme that converts acetyl-CoA to malonyl-CoA. And malonyl-CoA now continues the rest of the reaction to synthesize fatty acid. So what does it do? It increases the activity of this enzyme. And part of what it does is that the moment acetyl-CoA is produced, it wants to make sure that these acetyl-CoAs are cleared up and not used to synthesize glucose. So what it does is to channel them to the synthesis of fatty acid, and one of the ways to clear the glucose in the blood. Triglyceride synthesis. In triglyceride synthesis, elocution is an adipose acid. What does it do? Remember, a triglyceride contains a glycerol plus three fatty acid. What insulin does is to what? Is to increase the activity of the enzyme that breaks glycerol, that breaks triglyceride into glycerol and three fatty acid. Because it has ester bond that you need to break the three of them. So that is event. So what it does is to make sure it increases the activity of that lipase enzyme that breaks down triglycerol into glycerol and the various fatty acid. And once they are broken down, they can now enter into what? They can now be broken down by the body. That's exactly the action of insulin on adipocytes. Adipocytes are fatty acid stores or fatty acid storage cells. That's what we call them, the adipose tissue. That the cells of the adipose tissue. We call them the adipocyte. And having said that, we're not yet at the end of this lecture. Let's now talk a little bit more about diabetes and insulin. Alright, so we have different types of diabetes depending on the way to classify. But here we're going to be looking at three types of them. In type 1 diabetes, we call it insulin-dependent diabetes because the person is dependent on insulin, actually. Now, what happens here is that the person can make insulin. No, sorry, this is different. In insulin-dependent diabetes, the person cannot make insulin at all because the beta cells of the islets of the Langerhans has been destroyed. So the person cannot make insulin. There's absolute lack of insulin. Absolute or highly reduced level of insulin due to the destruction of those cells. These beta cells produce insulin. And when they cannot produce insulin because of destruction by particularly a type of autoimmune disease, the person cannot make any insulin at all. Now, this type is highly insulin dependent. To correct it, because the person has insulin cells, but does not have insulin. You have the insulin receptor. So if the person can always get injections of insulin from time to time, the body is going to actually respond well into metabolism of carbohydrate because the receptor cells are there, but the person cannot make it. That's what we call it type 1 diabetes. It is highly insulin dependent. In type 2 diabetes, which is called non-insulin dependent diabetes, what happens? The person can make insulin so well. The person can make insulin, the beta cells are active and can make enough insulin. However, the person lacks the insulin receptors to recognize those insulin. So there is insulin in the blood, but they cannot do anything because the cells cannot recognize them. There are no insulin receptors that can recognize them. And once they cannot recognize them, they cannot take up glucose into the cells and they cannot metabolize glucose. So it is characterized by cells not responding correctly to insulin, even when it is there in the blood. And then there's another one we call the adult onset diabetes. It starts much later in life and it only mainly affects people who are obese. And, you know, it's like I said, insulin is a metabolic disease. It tends to affect almost every part of the body because you look at what we saw in the last page, it affects the metabolism of almost all the fuel molecules. Now, in type 2 diabetes, there are some interesting current evidence that suggests that type 2 diabetes is related to the dysfunction of mitochondria. And it also said that individuals with type 2 diabetes are in increased risk of Alzheimer's disease. You know, Alzheimer's disease is as a result of increased level of the beta amyloid protein in the brain. Now, what happens? Because in type 2 diabetes, the person has insulin. There is a lot of insulin, but it cannot be used in the blood. That increase in level of insulin can lead to what? Can lead to increase in the level of beta amyloid plaques in the brain. So, again, insulin degrading enzyme is the enzyme that degrades insulin after its action. It's involved in binding and in degrading insulin. However, this insulin binds a beta amyloid proteins and clears it from the brain so that it will spend less time in clearing beta amyloid protein when insulin levels is high. So when it is too high, it is not going to clear it well, and this can has been said to contribute to the development of Alzheimer's disease in people who are type 2 diabetic. And having said that, we're going to be coming to an end of this lecture and an end of my lecture in this class. An end of module 24. Thank you once again for listening. It's been a roller coaster ride. I'll be seeing you during the next quiz and the final. Thank you. Bye at this point.